Friday night, Yankee Stadium. The Royals reach a height they never have before. Dan Quisenberry strikes out Willie Randolph, and the Royals sweep the Yankees, win a berth in the World Series, and await an opponent from the National League. In that league, a settlement takes 5 games and extra innings, finally in the Astrodome. A fly ball to Gary Maddox ends the waiting in Philly. Tonight, from Veterans Stadium, it's the Kansas City Royals and the Philadelphia Phillies in Game 1 of the 1980 World Series. The 1980 World Series, an inside look at the series and a preview of Game 1. Brought to you by Coleco, makers of head-to-head electronic sports games. And by Canon, so advanced, Canon is the world's leader in 35mm photography. There's a chill in the air, but a glowing warmth in the heart of Philadelphians who have waited 30 years for this moment, the opening game of the World Series, matching the Kansas City Royals against the Philadelphia Phillies here at Veterans Stadium. Good evening, I'm Bryant Gumbel, and welcome to Game 1 of the 1980 World Series, matching the Kansas City Royals against the Philadelphia Phillies. What do these two teams have in common? Well, they're both here, they both have rookie managers, but other than that, they are teams of very stark contrast. The Kansas City Royals, a team built on speed. The Philadelphia Phillies, one considered to have been built on power. Kansas City Royals swept through their season with the greatest of ease. The Phillies struggled, did it with great adversity, didn't wrap it up until the next to last day of the season. Even on into the league championships, there was a very big difference. The Royals swept aside the Yankees in 3 straight. For the Phillies, they had to endure 5 painful, excruciating games, with the Houston Astros 4 of those in extra innings. We're going to take a look at how they got here, starting with the Royals, who occupied first place for 121 days. The Royals broke camp with many of the same players that captured 3 division titles in 4 years, but there were some new additions, acquired from the Angels to supply some power Willie Akins, and over from the Orioles to take over the managership Jimmy Fry. The team was complete.
I think this year we had ingredients of everything. We had the pitching, the speed, the defense, and luckily we got power when we needed it. In Kansas City, we don't hit a lot of home runs, but on the road, ballparks are smaller, and we get our share of home runs.
Hitting their share of home runs and getting a lot of hits, the Royals collected runs at their usual pace, but they were missing Darryl Porter. He had a problem that was to keep him out of action during the early months. In those early months, they stumbled, playing barely 500 ball. They were carried by the strong left arm of Larry Gora, one of the few who believed Kansas City had plenty of pitching.
Yes, I do. I thought we've had the pitching staff since I've been over here. It's just a matter of getting the right breaks in the right situations, and this year we did that.
I think one of the big reasons probably is the year George Brett had, just a year of a lifetime. He seems to be getting better and better each year, though who knows what he might do next year or the years to come. Another big reason, I think, has been our bullpen this year. Definitely Dan Quisenberry was our best pitcher in the bullpen.
The bullpen, like the pitching staff, it had been a question mark in the minds of many, but by season's end, it was strong. Dennis Leonard leading the staff with 20 wins, and what the starters couldn't finish, Dan Quisenberry did, filling the void in KC that it had never been filled before.
I didn't think I'd completely fill it like what happened. I didn't predict 33 saves. I thought I would do better than I did last year. I thought we'd have a much better bullpen because between Rene Martin and myself, and I thought Marty Patton had the best spring of any pitcher in Royal camp, that someone was going to emerge. And between Rene and myself, I thought one of us had the capabilities of becoming a good relief pitcher in the American League.
Quisenberry was not the only KC surprise. Darryl Porter, behind the plate and rejoicing here, had little reason to believe he'd ever reach that point when he tearfully rejoined the team in midseason.
I went to Joe Burke and I advised him that I was a drug addict and an alcoholic. And my whole life was being really affected by it. And I've heard my family and I've heard my friends. And I've heard all the great baseball fans in Kansas City, my teammates, and I almost destroyed myself.
after the Royals took all the suspense out of the American West race by midseason, center stage belonged to their all-star third baseman, George Brett. And his quest to become the first man in 40 years to hit 400, it had its pressures.
Like the first day in Texas, we went down there. It was the first day after I went over 400, where I went from one TV station to another, to another, to another. And by the time I was through doing that, I missed half a batting practice. So the organization got behind me. They helped me out a lot. It was a lot of fun. I think I changed a little bit. I was getting more rest than I ever did before. I became a little bit superstitious, and I found out afterwards I shouldn't change horses in the middle of the stream because I think it ruined me. But I had a good time with it. I'm just a little, not embarrassed, but a little upset with myself that I came 10 points short.
After winning the West in a breeze, the Royals moved on to the American League Championship Series, and with Frank White winning the Most Valuable Player Award, ridded themselves of a longtime nemesis in the Yankees.
But this season, with the turnover of a lot of players that beat us are gone, and while we felt that if any year we could beat the Yankees, this would be the year.
Appropriately enough, it was George Brett who put the capper on the championship with a three-run homer off Goose Gossage following a two-out single by UL Washington.
When UL beat out that infield hit, I was very happy that I was the next guy coming up. Gossage, I knew, would be throwing anywhere between 95 and 200 miles an hour, and I just went up to myself. I said to myself, hey, don't get cheated. Swing hard, swing quick, and try to pull the ball, and if you can, get it in the air. And I did all three, so I was very, very happy.
The Royals joined Brett in being very, very happy. They made it to the final step. Tonight, they begin their quest of their first world title. George Brett, before the regular season, before the league championships, you felt confident, you made it look easy. Is the same feeling there as you had in game one?
Well, we're confident right now. Of course we are, or else we wouldn't be here right now. I think the attitude on the ball club is if we can go out and play good baseball like we did against the New York Yankees, get good defense, good timely hitting, we can beat the Philadelphia Phillies. And if we can go out there and execute correctly, I think we can beat them. If we go out there and play like the Houston Astros did and the Philadelphia Phillies did in game four, I believe, it's going to be awfully tough to beat these guys. They're a great ball club.
Quickly, do you expect an advantage because they're a tired team?
No, I don't think that has anything to do with it. This is the World Series. You can reach back for a little bit extra. They're not tired right now. They're very happy to be here. We're very happy to be here. I think it's going to be a lot of fun the next week.
George Brett, thank you much.
Okay,
best of luck. We'll take a look at the Philadelphia Phillies and the end of the 30 years of frustration in the city of brotherly love. We'll get to how they got here.
Hey, Dad.
Yeah.
When do you think I'm going to start shaving?
It's going to be a few years, son, but when you do, you got something great to look forward to.
Aquavelva, right, Dad?
Right. Aquavelva's real cooling. It picks you up after a shave. And it's got a fresh, clean fragrance that the girls in your class are going to love. Aquavelva, it makes a man.
Feel like a man, right, Dad?
All right.
There's something about an Aquavelva man.
Let's check the scoreboard and see how Coleco's head-to-head electronic baseball stacks up against the competition. Sure, some games have base stealing and pitch selection. But for real two-player action, only head-to-head baseball has computed batting averages for each player, hitting for average or for extra power, 16 pitching variations, including a pitch-out, extra inning scoring, and more. It's no contest. Get head-to-head electronic baseball by Coleco now that you know the score.
Can you see the difference between Firestone's steel-belted Trax 12 and other all-season radials? Firestone has special traction bars for pulling power in snow, but they're hidden in the Trax 12 tread for smooth, quiet turnpike driving. Long-lasting Trax 12, the all-season steel-belted radial with traction you can see. Traction 12 months a year. Trax 12, Firestone's lowest-priced steel-belted white-wall radial.
In marked contrast to the Royals' season that was filled with peace and harmony, the Philadelphia Phillies had a season of confrontation and controversy. Confrontation with a new manager in Dallas Green and a team seeking an identity. They were in first place only 16 days. It was a strong Philly team that started the season, a team complete with the big names that had made it a favorite for many years.
If you picked the Phillies for 79, you should pick them for 1980, because there was no way we were going to go through the injuries that we went through in 79. Plus, we had some young talent, guys like Keith Moreland, Vukovic for the bench. We had Unser, we had Gross, great pinch hitters, and we had a pretty good bullpen. So I said, you better pick us for 80 if you're going to pick us for 79.
Though the 1980 Phillies continued to look like the Phillies of old on the field, there was an attitude change brought about by a new manager.
The credit has to be given to Dallas Green, in addition to a lot of us maybe maturing a little bit. You know, the crux of the team now, we're all 31, 32 years old. The Luzinskis, the Boones, Maddoxes, myself, Boa. We ought to be old enough now to have some character. We've been through enough hell on the baseball field in the playoffs in the past. And Dallas Green's blend of the young players on the team is very important also.
Though the Phillies struggled in the early going, they continued to get fine performances from some of their more unheralded players. Second baseman Manny Trio turned in stout defense and toyed with the 300 mark all year long. And right fielder Bake McBride, though he continued to have his problems with manager Dallas Green, responded with a 300 season and 87 RBI. But all the hustle and all the effort that was a part of this Phillies season was interrupted by accusations of a drug scandal in mid-July.
I built a reputation here in 10 years, and in one day, it's down the drain. Not only for me, my wife, my mom and dad out in California, and everything that I've been accused of is totally wrong. It's false. There's no true information at all linked to me and narcotics.
After surviving the scandal and hitting a low point in early August, the Phils came on strong, winning 36-55. They went to Montreal having to win two, and did win two, to clinch the National East title. Mike Schmidt providing the winning runs with his 48th home run to go with a season that included 121 RBI. Indeed, when Tug McGraw struck out Larry Parrish to clinch the National East title with a winning run on base, cap off a season that included a 1.46 ERA and 20 saves, his joy, his effort, his achievement typified the spirit of a team that had won almost in spite of itself.
The Phillies have reached back all year long. We've had our backs to the wall. We've made it as tough as we could for ourselves, and we felt real strong about going up there. We'd gone that far, and we'd come down that close, and we just felt all the way that we were going to be able to win it. We had that feeling, you might say.
After winning their mini pennant in Montreal, the Phillies moved on to the National League Championship Series and took part in the bizarre battles of Houston. There they survived the Astros, their own mistakes, and a most incredible series of plays. There was the Gary Maddox ball that went from a 1-3 putout to a triple play to a double play. There was the line drive to right that was called a catch, but it appeared to be a trap. It scored a run, but brought on yet another strange double play. And through it all, through the five games that included four extra inning affairs, there was a Philly team that continued to fight back when they appeared to be on the edge of elimination. An exhausting, emotionally draining series filled with more than its share of heroes and improbable happenings, the MVP was himself an improbable hero, Manny Trio.
To tell you the truth, I was willing to win the most valuable player on my team. But it happened the other way, and I think it's, right now it's more bigger than the one I was looking for. And besides, I told my wife I'm going to get it for her, so I think I did it.
When Enos Cabell hit a Dick Ruthven pitch into the waiting glove of Gary Maddox, it brought to an end 30 years of frustration in Philadelphia. Tonight, the Phillies will attempt to begin to do what the Phillies of 15 and 50 could not do, win a first world title for the city of brotherly love. Mike Schmidt, the Phillies are coming off of a series that was emotionally and physically draining in Houston. Is there any way that you can get up and stay with a team that's fresh like the Royals?
Oh, are you kidding? Some people would say that not playing for two or three days might make you a worse team. We're ready to go. This is a World Series. This is a chance to play in front of the whole world, Brian, and there ain't nobody over there that's tired or emotionally drained or anything. We're ready to go, and we're ready to prove it, prove a lot of people wrong. I think a lot of people are picking KC in this thing, and we're going to do our best to prove them wrong.
Mike Schmidt, thank you very much.
All right.
Best of luck.
Okay.
We're going to step aside just for a moment, come back with some final comments. Game one of the 1980 World Series in a couple of moments.
The fun side of John Newcomb. That's what I was shooting for. That's why I was shooting with my Canon AE-1.
Ready?
It's different from most cameras because even on automatic, I get the shutter speed I need for really clear, sharp shots.
Oh!
Try the flash, John.
What do I do?
It's a cinch. The AE-1 is so easy to use. Even with a flash, about all you do is focus and click.
The incomparable Canon AE-1. So advanced, it's simple.
Watch out. Winter's almost here. And wind's gonna get you. And cold's gonna get you. And high fuel bills are gonna get you. Because you still haven't added more insulation to your attic. So do it now. Get more Owens Corning fiberglass insulation and add another layer to put your house in the pink. See your dealer or contractor. Buy more Owens Corning fiberglass insulation now before winter gets you.
With good reason is baseball's World Series, often referred to as the Fall Classic. Baseball's finest teams and baseball's finest hour set to go at it in Game 1 of the World Series. For the Royals, 20-game winner Dennis Leonard. His opponent on the mound for Philadelphia, a rookie Bob Walk. We'll get to it after this update from NBC News.
This is NBC News Update.
The Kansas City Royals went at Walk like a sacrificial lamb. In the second inning, Amos Otis followed a leadoff Walk with a home run to left, and the Royals had a 2-0 lead. They doubled that lead in the third when Willie Akins hit a two-out homer with a man on. Nerves weren't destroying Philly's rookie, but the Royals were.
The main reason I was out there was try to give our bullpen a rest and go as long as I could. I got off to a bad start, with the home runs and everything. I was high in the strike zone. And I just tried to keep us in the ball game as long as I could and give 6-7 good strong innings, and hopefully somebody could come in and pick me up.
The pickup Walk needed arrived in the form of the Philly offense in the third inning. Larry Boa became the first Philly to reach base, and he quickly surprised everyone by stealing second. The move shook up Leonard and woke up the Phillies. Bob Boone then collected the first of his two doubles, the first of his three hits on the night, a corner shot that made it 4-1 Kansas City. Then Lonnie Smith kept the rally alive with a single pass to diving UL Washington. Willie Wilson's throw to the plate stopped Boone, but caught Smith between first and second. While Brett cautiously advanced on the speedy Smith, Washington never moved over to cover third, and Boone sped home. The Royals made Smith the inning second out, but the play had produced a second Philadelphia run and increased Kansas City frustration. Suddenly, Pete Rose was up, the crowd was up, and the Kansas City fortunes were taking a downturn. Leonard wound, and Rose's knee remained in the path of a slider. An ensuing walk to Schmidt brought Vake McBride to the plate. He completed a 5-run Philly outburst with a shot over the wall in right center. And Pete Rose gleefully led the parade home that put Philly up 5-4. Leonard, Kansas City's right-handed ace, had lost a big lead, and the 65,791 on hand were on their feet. Given the lead, Bob Walk found new strength and new stuff. He settled down and protected the lead by retiring 9 in a row.
When I went in, I told them that, hey, you guys, come on, pick me up a little bit, and they definitely did. They went on and scored the 5 runs, and then I went out there on the mound and started doing a few things different, turned over my fastball, not trying to blow by everybody, and things turned around for me, and I got a few people out in a row and just started gaining confidence, and everything started snowballing.
Things continued to snowball for the Phillies. While Walk was breezing along, the Phillies padded his lead. They got a run in the fourth on a Boone double and added another in the fifth to make it a 7-4 ball game. It stayed that way until the eighth, when George Brett collected his only hit of the night, a double up the alley in left center. That was followed by a Willie Akins shot over the wall in right center, and suddenly it was 7-6 Kansas City. Following it out, Amos Otis was aboard as the tying run, and Dallas Green had to go to the bullpen to summon Tug McGraw. He came in a very tired pitcher, but a ready pitcher.
Before the game, I felt a little bit stiff, and I took some heat and a cup of Tylenol, and when I got the call in the bullpen to warm up, the adrenaline started to flow, and I knew I could reach back and find it if they had to use me, so it felt real good to be able to do it.
Whatever it was Tug McGraw had to reach back for, he did find. He induced John Watson to hit into an inning-ending 6-4-3 double play, and suddenly the Kansas City threat in the eighth was no more. It was 7-6, one out in the ninth, when Tug McGraw froze UL Washington with a fastball that put Philly within one out of victory. The count went to 2-2 on Willie Wilson, and the game ended as it had started, with Willie Wilson striking out. Philadelphia had a victory, 7-6, before 65,791 at the Vet. Tonight, the Phillies try to go two up, and Kansas City tries to get even in Game 2 of the 1980 World Series. NBC Sports presents the 1980 World Series, an inside look at the series and a preview of Game 2. Brought to you by The Hartford and its independent agents who can protect your business, home, auto, and life. and by Denerex Shampoo. Help stop dandruff itch with an extra relief medicine, Denerex. After waiting 65 years for a series victory, last night's 7-6 Phillies win merely whet the appetites of the citizens of the City of Brotherly Love, who've packed the vet tonight looking for series win number 2 against the Kansas City Royals. Good evening, I'm Brian Gumbel. We're going to get to the series in just a moment, but first, this word on a breaking news story. This comes from San Francisco. It says a team of vascular surgeons, the University of California at San Francisco, has announced that Houston Astros pitcher James Rodney Richard was operated on yesterday in an 18-hour procedure to replace an obstructed artery in his right shoulder. The operation appeared to be successful, the surgeons declared, and the outlook for Richard's return to baseball appears to be good. That can only be good news to all baseball fans. Our prayers continue to be with JR, not only for his return to baseball, but in the hopes that he can lead a normal life. Here at the series, the health outlook, well, the big story revolves around George Brett. There was some thought that he would not even be able to play tonight. His condition, well, he has a blockage of blood vessels forcing a protrusion of tissue from the rectum. In layman's language, he has hemorrhoids. That is a laughing matter to some people, but it is no laughing matter to the people who experience the pain of that condition. We talked to the Kansas City trainer. Mickey, how much pain is George dealing with tonight?
Well, George, at the moment, is in quite a bit of pain. He's probably got as much pain as compared to any injury that he's had this year with an injury. And we hope to alleviate some of that by game time.
How will his condition affect his play?
Well, I think he's going to be slowed down a little bit with his sprinting if he should hit a ball that would take him, say, to third base.
Does his condition figure to sideline him for any games in the series?
Well, we certainly hope not. He's taking proper treatment that's been prescribed by the physicians, and with a proper rest between games, we hope he's going to be able to play quite often in the World Series.
So down one game in the World Series, the Royals have a hampered superstar in third baseman George Brett. He will bear watching tonight as the Royals face Steve Carlton and send Larry Gura to the mound to oppose him. We're going to step aside for a moment. We come back. We'll have some laughs with former umpire Ron Luciano as the umpire strikes back after this.
Last year in Wellsboro, Pennsylvania, while Mrs. Montgomery's class made a history field trip, history was being made. Commonwealth Telephone and ITT installed some optical fiber telephone lines. Optical fibers carry phone signals by laser light. The cables can be lashed over existing lines, and they can carry more traffic. Today, Wellsboro has an optical fiber phone system in everyday use, and some more history to remember.
Head and Shoulders doesn't have it. Selsun Blue doesn't have it. Only Denerex has it. An extra relief medicine to stop dandruff itch. You can feel it tingle.
All three have one medicine for dandruff itch, but only Denerex adds a second medicine, an exclusive anti-itch medicine many dermatologists recommend.
You can feel it tingle. That's extra relief medicine, and only Denerex has it.
In regular or new Mountain Fresh Herbal, Denerex stops dandruff itch with an extra relief medicine.
At JCPenney Auto Centers, we won't give you the business because we want to keep your business.
They didn't sell me the JCPenney battery. They said the 5-year battery was powerful enough for my car. It was.
I thought I needed new shock absorbers. They told me my tires were too hard.
I came in for ordinary radials. I came out with new Mileage Maker XP all-season steel-belted radials. They steered me right.
JCPenney Auto Centers.
During his career as a major league umpire, Ron Luciano became known as an umpire who did things in an unusual fashion. Well, now that he's joined us as an NBC reporter, we find that Ron still has an unusual way of reporting.
Since 1903, baseball teams have battled their way through the summer, much in the same way the Jedi Knights have battled their way through the universe. I was the dreaded enemy. I had great authority. There are a few good times along the way. Eventually, though, the battles wore me out, and I stopped my warlike ways. But now... Empire Strikes Back. You all remember Luke Skywalker. He fights hard, plays clean, and seems to have the Force with him. You know who he reminds me of? Steve Harvey. Every mother's son and every kid's hero. He works hard and he pulls the team together. His bat and his glove are the weapons he uses in those long summer battles. In just the same way that Skywalker had his teacher Yoda, Harvey's Yoda is Tom Sawyer. He moves funny. He sounds funny. And he's very wise. Most of the time. You know, there's a guy this season who has played with reckless abandon. Just the same way in which Han Solo carries out his duties, there is no question that George Brett is Han Solo. Brett's bat is the fiercest weapon in the universe. And his defense is superb. Watch out for that approaching asteroid. Han Solo's adversary was good old Lando Calrissian. Brett has his landmark. And it's nobody other than Mr. October, Reggie Jackson. There are times he seems to hurt Han Solo, but there are times he helps him too. We have some strange creatures here. Jose Cruz is a lot like that. He's got his hair, but his quiet consistency helps Houston along. One of my two favorites is C-3PO. Although he is very helpful, he can never be just seen and not heard. He seems to fall to pieces too. He reminds me of another space character, Montreal's Bill Lee. Even though Lee is not a real spaceman, he could rival C-3PO in talk and in space. I almost forgot to tell you about my favorite little guy, R2-D2. R2 is really a cute little fellow. R2-D2 and I have known each other for a long time. He sure is cute when he gets rough. So baseball is not as different from space as you might have imagined. In this World Series, for whomever you may be rooting, may the Force be with you.
Don't wait for someday. Geritol is for now.
I used to think I was too young for Geritol, but now I know better.
I learned a long time ago that it really pays to take care of yourself. That's why I take a Geritol tablet every morning, to be sure I'm getting enough iron and important vitamins.
Geritol, America's number one iron and vitamin supplement, with double the iron of any ordinary supplement. Don't wait for someday. Geritol is for now.
Geritol, every day.
This thief knows more about the value of your silver than you do. That's why there's an alarming number of silver thefts today. Unfortunately, most homeowners' policies limit coverage to just $1,000. The Hartford can help by showing you ways to make certain your silver coverage keeps pace with its full value. To protect your business, home, or... Hartford. Let us protect your world.
Hoping to go two up, the Phillies send the National League's best pitcher to the mound tonight. It'll be 24-game winner Steve Carlton going against the Royals and 18-game winner Larry Gura in Game 2 of the 1980 World Series. And that game coming up right here on NBC following this update.